Namaste. I hope you can understand my pronunciation. And I want to tell you, there must be many among you who know much more about Sanatana Dharma. And I accepted the invitation not because I know more about Sanatana Dharma, but because I grew up as a Christian and maybe can value it even better and can see more clearly why it is so special. And also I noticed that it is very difficult for you to mention anything about the dogmas of other religions. So that is the reason. I want to first touch on why Sanatana Dharma is best. Then I want to come why it is portrayed as worst. Then I want to come to the common aspects and what is different between Hindu Dharma and Christianity and Islam. And in the end, I want to come to the point that we have to bring truth back into the discourse about religion. It is lacking nowadays. So I want to start with a shloka from the Vedas. And please join in if you know it. It basically means, may our study be fruitful, may no enmity arise between us. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahana Punaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavati Tamastu Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Sanskrit is the oldest language and the most perfect. How is it possible? I mean, there's no doubt that India is the cradle of civilization. Even if Google search or Wikipedia tells that it is Mesopotamia, it can't be true. And the rishis had so much knowledge. And you have this great treasure of knowledge about all fields in, I mean, from mathematics, music, and medicine, and economy, and I mean, in every field you have so much knowledge. But I want to touch here mainly on one point which impressed me most when I came to India 38 years ago. And it is this point that all this is Brahman. Brahman has become all this. Everything is permeated by the one great Brahman. It means it is also in us. It has a great, I mean, it is very important for our life, ultimately. So when I came to India, I landed up in Kanyakumari by chance. There was a memorial for Swami Vivekananda, and I bought the book Jnana Yoga there. And when I read it, it just said what I always felt is true, but what I couldn't have expressed so clearly. It impressed me so much that I really wanted to live accordingly. But I had no idea how to live. What impressed me was that there is like one ocean, like Brahman, and the waves are like the persons. And we, the person, think we are separate, we have a separate form, and we see only other waves, and some of us even are very firm that there is no ocean at all. And but ultimately, when our form goes, we are nothing but the ocean. And there's also an example given why we don't see the truth. Because that the mind, just the mind, can completely reveal the truth. When there's a rope lying on the ground and it's dim light, so then we can, if I think it is a snake, I see only a snake and I'm frightened and everything. And it's I look straight at the rope. I look at the truth, but I think it is something else. So basically, we look always only at Brahman, at the divine, and we see something else, but we have to discover this. That is a meaning of life also, that we try to discover the truth about ourselves. So that this that divinity is in us, it has to sink in. I mean, we have to put it into our lives. And for me, it was a little easier because soon after, I landed up at the Kumbh Mela in Hardwar in 1980, at Ardha Kumbh it was. And there I met Devaraha Baba and Anandamayi Ma. And in their surroundings, it became much easier. I started to read Upanishads, I started to read a lot. And especially Anandamayi Ma, sorry. Anandamayi Ma, she stressed very much on bhakti. She said, feel that Bhagwan is moving your legs when you walk. Feel actually in his loving embrace. And feel 24 hours a day, be aware of his presence. So when I got up in the morning, I wanted to be aware 24 hours a day. And when I brushed my teeth, I had already forgotten about it. But I mean, the aspiration is there, and in this surrounding, it was much easier. So that's when I started to write about it also. Now, is it true that the divine is really in us? I mean, just the claim does not mean it is also true, no? So first we have the insights of the rishis. They said we have experienced it. And second, we have also the Upanishads. They explain how to come to this conclusion by questioning. Upanishads are a question answer in many cases. No? So am I the body? No. Am I the mind? No. Always changing. I am unchanging. I have a body. I have a mind. So this is one point that you come by jnana yoga, that you question what is true, what can I really know about truth? And one comes to the conclusion that actually I can only know that I am, nothing else. I cannot say you are there because I may be dreaming. And actually the rishis claim that this is more like a dream or like a virtual reality. It is not the real thing, what we see here. No? And now science also supports it. They came to the conclusion all is one energy. And the rishis say this energy is conscious. I think the scientists, they will have to turn inside to discover this, but at least they have discovered that all is one. There are no separate objects, no separate entities at all. So now how to live life? Basically, you follow Dharma, and Dharma is inbuilt in us. We have a conscience which tells us what is right and wrong. And if we are if we are not sure what is right and wrong, then scriptures also help. And then you have such a wonderful division also, like the stages in life. According, a student has a different dharma from an old man or from a householder. And also according to your profession, what you are doing, you have a different dharma. So you have such a wonderful, complete system, and the mindset which it makes is the most ideal for harmoniously living together, because Bhagavan is in me. It means I can draw my strengths from inside. I should do it now, maybe. I'm not used to speaking, I have to tell you. But he's also in you. That means you are kind to others, also in animals, in nature. So you let everybody live, and you live and let live. The most ideal way for the golden rule, I don't do to others what you don't want to be done to you. And also, one more point I should mention, why are there so many gods in Hinduism? And actually, this gods is a very mischievous translation for devas. Devas are powers which are greater than the human being and which are absolutely essential for our existence here. Like for the sun, for example. We could not live without the sun. So if we do pranam to the sun, it makes sense because everything is conscious. Everything is, I mean, I am composed of 3 billion cells. I mean, so, but a Westerner would say, what nonsense, how can you, just a ball of helium, no? So this is, your view is much, much better. And all the devas are ultimately, of course, also nothing but Brahman. And the Upanishads, they clearly express it, that Ganapati, for example, is Brahman. Devi is Brahman. Only this really exists, but there are options for trying to approach the undescribable, unimaginable truth by even loving devas, or by loving a form which helps somehow. And therefore it's also no problem in India that so many streams are side by side. There are people who worship Shiva, who worship Krishna, who worship Devi. It doesn't matter. It is everybody is accepting this. But now, why is Indian culture and Hindu Dharma so much vilified? There's so much unfair, relentless attack. You are called intolerant, oppressing women, Dalits, minorities, religious minorities. Even now in recent years, rapists, terrorists. I mean, it's completely unfair. It's so much out of it's simply, it has to have an agenda. It cannot be honest or sincere. Like on German TV, Arundhati Roy came, for example, and she was telling about how women are oppressed in India, and how, and on Gonsalves, I don't know his first name, he was saying that every minute so many women are raped. I mean, it was absolutely terrible. They just make India, put India down. So I feel the reason is basically because India has so much knowledge, and because nobody should know how profound the knowledge in India is, and nobody should get interested in India. So it is usually, don't talk about India except in negative terms. And the reason was probably because otherwise people may desert the church. And this actually happened when the Vedas first reached the West, Western universities. The elite in the West, they were very much impressed. Voltaire, for example, Voltaire was in the forefront of fighting the church. He was saying the Vedas are the greatest gift to humanity, and we are eternally indebted to India. And he went to prison for fighting the church. And so many others in Germany also, people who praised the Vedas. So the church was already in education because they had to indoctrinate their children. So I feel the agenda was, Hinduism was coined, a new word, and it was put side by side with religion. And immediately, of course, as an inferior religion, because Christianity has the only true God, so, and Hindus have so many gods, so it must be inferior. And I, for example, knew already in primary school that India has a caste system. These two things, many gods, wrong, because we have the true God, and many caste, and caste system, very oppressive, very bad, untouchable. I remember this untouchable, unberührbare in German. It left a big impression on me when I was in school. And I did not know at the time that 100 kilometers from my place, there was a concentration camp. I went to school in the 50s, early 60s, and I came to know about concentration camps only in high school because a professor for Latin, a teacher of Latin, showed us a documentary. He made it a point to educate us. Otherwise, we would have not known, really. But we know about India one thing, and this one thing is caste system. And this definitely is also a very mischievous agenda. It was, and then, of course, Macaulay came. He, in 1835, he proposed to cut off Indians from their great culture and introduce India English education system, which is still doing so much harm to India now. And at the same time, you were told that your tradition is not worth anything. And there is a lecture on the net, not a lecture, a talk written, of one professor in Tübingen University, a German university of 1839, 4 years after Macaulay. And there he tells that, oh, we are very lucky because recently a missionary has come from India. A missionary is from our area. He has come back from India and he has donated to our university 11 volumes of ancient manuscripts. And he called it a great ornament, great treasure. And then he said, but of course, our treasure is very small compared to the treasures which are in the India House in London. So they knew very well the value of it. I don't. There is a podcast on the net with K.S. Balasubramaniam, Professor K.S. Balasubramaniam from Kuppuswamy Research Institute in Chennai. And there he says it can be taken on record, he says that Dr. Padma Subramaniam, a famous dancer and scientist, she went for a program in Leningrad, St. Petersburg. And there she went to the museum, and the director of the museum showed her the Indian manuscripts department. And he told her that there are over 1,000 manuscripts, and the Russians had captured them from the Germans. And among those palm leaves, there was one on missiles. And Russia built its first intercontinental ballistic missile on the knowledge from this palm leaf. He said, and they say so many things which are in this ancient text. In fact, I met in 1984 once a German from a German university, and he had a project for 2 years in India to search the ancient text, not for spiritual clues, but for scientific clues. So it means the West takes it very seriously, but you are told not to take it seriously, and I am sure if your academia, your academics, the Western English universities would not look to the West, but would cooperate with Sanskrit pandits who don't speak English or who speak English badly, they have much more knowledge still. And then modern science would not be Western science, but it would be Indian science. And I said, anyway, it is Indian science because they steal it, but don't tell you really. One more point. Often when people call me Sanghi sometimes, no? and the same thing thrown at me, which maybe are thrown at you also. For example, don't you know in the Manusmriti there is this molten lead is poured into the ears of Dalits if by chance they heard the Vedas, no? I am sure it is interpolated. It cannot be in the original text. Or also Brahmins were eating beef. I mean, when you see what else is there in the text, it just cannot be. I mean, it is so out of... And those who translated the text, and they were not well-meaning towards you. So don't take it at face value. Immediately some people go into defensive and try to, well, we can change it and it is not so important. Don't believe it. But I feel times are changing. Indians have great brains, there's no doubt. I mean, I really admire your capacities. And I think it is even would be much more if you do sadhana, trying to discover this divinity in you. And for example, Srinivas Ramanujan. Sometimes I imagine he had gone to a television studio and told Arnab Goswami, by the way, I got these formulas in my dream. How would we react, no? But it is true. I really feel the rishis, he had an access to a different level of consciousness. And this is there. It is now also there. And we have to develop the capacity to access this different planes. Now to the point, common and different aspects between Sanatana Dharma and the religions, Christianity and Islam. Common is they all worship one supreme. So often it is said, so what is wrong? No? We all worship God, whether you call him like this or that. There was even somebody on TV once, he said, what does it matter if I worship Krishna or Christ? And I feel that is quite ignorance, because there's a big difference. The church started with this claim that we alone have the truth. God wants all to believe this only, and if you don't believe it, you go eternally to hell. No evidence, no proof, a claim. And Islam followed a few centuries later. So the Christian God, they tell a story. They say, 2,000 years ago, God has sent his only son to earth. And because God had compassion, because all humanity is still suffering from the original sin, so through his death and resurrection, we get saved by him. But there's one condition. You have to acknowledge Jesus as the Son of God and have to believe in him and have to get baptized. And nobody, of course, heard it in the beginning, but as soon as it became state religion in the Roman Empire, the Christians went also berserk. They looted, they burned temples, destroyed temples. Even Sitaram Goel says there were Hindu temples in Rome also, and killed intellectuals. They went all over Syria, Egypt, and that's how they got up to now 2 billion followers. In the beginning, a lot of violence. In Germany, 800 AD, refusal of baptism was death sentence. If you refused baptism, you could be killed, would be killed. And there's a comment by one of the advisors of the king, of the emperor, Karl, and he said, yes, you can force them to baptism, but how can you force them to believe? But the church managed to force to believe even to a certain extent, because they indoctrinated children. And when you were born in a Christian family, you cannot leave. I mean, you cannot get out. In Germany, you could get out only in 1847. And in Spain, only in 1978. They got religious freedom, means they could leave the church. Before that, you were bound. And religion comes from religare, Latin. It means to bind. Earlier, I used to be very charitable, and I thought, oh, maybe they mean to bind to God. And but it basically means to bind to a doctrine. Otherwise, why would this term religion be used without, I mean, Christianity was there, and it was also used when the Turks were in front of Vienna. It was for the first time used also for Islam, the religion of the Muslim. So this religion definitely means to bind to a doctrine. And it is a doctrine which is, it requires blind belief. Now there's one issue. Of course, the Christian God is jealous of other God. He loves his followers, hates the others. And man must not think about it, because man can never know the truth. That's what we are told. You just have to believe, because God has revealed it. There's one thing, but they also tell you, on one hand, they try to manipulate you and make you like sheep to follow. And on the other hand, they tell you that you are chosen. You are very lucky. As a child, I knew already, you are so lucky because you are born in the right religion. God loves you. You know the true God. And like this, no? And all these others. I remember once in primary school, a missionary came from India, and he was telling, he was making us pray. I don't know how I remember this, that we were praying for the poor, hungry, heathen children in India, that they also hear of dear Jesus and are saved like us. So some of these missionaries may really be serious. I mean, they really may believe it, that they have to bring you out from the darkness or whatever. But they have to be made, we have to stand up also and make show them that it's not like this. Another point which is terrifying for children and which you usually cannot imagine is eternal hell. No, really. I mean, you may laugh, but it's really true. I was 9 years when a friend who was Protestant, she convinced me not to go to church on Mass on Sunday, to Mass on Sunday. Protestants, for them, it was not a terrible sin. For us Catholics, it was a terrible sin. You would go straight to hell. So we played. I did not go. I didn't tell my parents. But afterwards, I was so terrified that I could die before I had confessed my sin to the priest. Once a month, we went for confession. We had to tell whatever we did wrong. And so I was really, really frightened. Now I also can't imagine anymore, but I remember that I was really frightened. If I die now, if a car hits me or whatever, and for all eternity I will be in hellfire. I mean, if you imagine it, there's an ex-Muslim on the net. I heard him recently, he's now an atheist somehow. And he said it frightened him so much that he decided, he said, Eternity, even 1 year is too much, even 10 minutes is too much. And he even put a matchstick on his skin, and he said, it's painful, no? So then he said, I found out, it's basically usually the more sincere people who really believe it also, no? Who follow, others couldn't care less maybe, but those who are sincere, they take it seriously. So he found out that boys up to 15 years in Islam cannot make any sin before the age of reason, which is 15 years for boys and 9 years for girls. He goes to paradise if he dies. So he decided to do suicide. And he tells it that when he was 12, he jumped out from the window of his school and broke two legs and broke one arm and damaged his spine, was 3 months in hospital, lost one year in school. His parents were devastated. They sent him afterwards to counseling. And he said, I wanted to say accidentally I fell, but he couldn't tell his parents because he gave his watch to a friend before he jumped. But I mean, you take it seriously, because those boys say, yeah, when you are 12 and you believe it, how can you change when you are 18 suddenly? You still believe it, no? One more important thing happened, that the church did a lot of first. The first started this claim that only we are right and everybody has to believe it. Islam followed. And then the church also, in 553 AD, there was a council in Constantinople, and there they decided to call the belief in rebirth wrong. You must not believe in rebirth. Up to then, it was very common that people believed in rebirth. Even Jews believe in reincarnation. And even now, so the Bible was clear, there are two instances in the Bible which clearly say, yeah, it is, only explanation is that there is rebirth. So they forbade the belief. That means people are more they are more frightened. How can I experiment if I have only one life? Maybe the church is right. That is, many people think like this. Maybe they are right. What if? And so better stick to them. Islam, of course, has even today blasphemy laws in Pakistan. Imagine you get killed for your voicing your opinion. And one thing is very painful, in that in the Quran, violence is permitted, basically, against kafirs. No? And there's a Turkish Cypriot, recently was giving an interview. He's now in his 80s, 85, 87, old man. And now they wonder whether they will have to, they will persecute him. He admitted in this interview that in the 1970s, he was there and was killing Christian Greeks. There was killing kafirs. So then somebody asked him, the interviewer asked him, was it difficult to kill them, the Greeks, your neighbors, basically? And then I couldn't believe, but he really said it. Nothing more pleasurable than to kill kafirs. I mean, imagine. And for some type of man, this type has an attraction. And we need to be honest. We need to see it also. And the state of affairs in the lands which have converted to Christianity and Islam, all have converted. There's no Christian and no Muslim in the world who has not ancestors who were not Christian or Muslims. Because they came only recently, no? 2,000 years ago, and they were pushed to convert. Because it doesn't make sense. So that's why they had to use violence and also indoctrination. Now, since we can get out of the church, of course, many, many have got out. In Europe now, Germany has 55% Christians. In England now, it's not a Christian country anymore, they were saying. And but the problem is that we are lost. We become atheists. Big moral degradation in our countries. Amazing. A friend recently, he's from America, and he went to America and came back. He said, "You can't believe what moral degradation has happened in the last 30 years in America. It is really painful." And no meaning in life. People don't see a meaning, they think enjoy. And it's a very sad state somehow. And in Muslim countries, of course, it's very regimented, and women are oppressed. Yesterday only I saw a woman, a Pakistani woman, with the elections, was telling life for women in Pakistan is very difficult, she was saying on TV. Now compare this with India, liveliness and colorfulness. And when I came to India, actually, I was really envying Hindu children that they are not brainwashed into eternal hell, that nobody frightens them, really. I mean, you can't imagine, but we take it seriously. And especially children, when somebody big tells them something, eternal hell, no? So, yeah. Now the point, I feel it is a duty of Hindus and Buddhists and others, because Christianity and Islam are basically in the same boat, to bring truth back into this whole discourse. Or better even, to bring the quest for truth, which is Hindu Dharma, instead of religion, instead of this binding to a doctrine. Why should anybody be bound? I mean, we are all born free, or what is, I don't know, human rights charter. And we have to see that in the name of Christianity and Islam, a lot of suffering happened. And therefore, we also should not shy away from finding out what it is and try to convince them to get this inclusive mindset of Sanatana Dharma. It is very strange when Christianity and Islam convert Hindus, nobody has any objection. But if only one family comes back to Hindu Dharma, big shouting. I mean, this is absolutely incomprehensible. I mean, it needs to be the other way around. When you are born a Christian, you are not allowed to think freely. You cannot, I think Voltaire was it, who said, God has given me intelligence, I think he wants me to use it. So we are not meant to use it, actually. Now, why is Sanatana Dharma superior and the others inferior? Is because they are based only on blind belief in a story. There's no evidence whatsoever. And it has harmful consequences also. I don't think colonialism would have been possible, such brutal colonialism, if we would not have this attitude that we are chosen by God, we are superior, we have the true God, he's on our side. And also the Muslim invasions, they couldn't have been so brutal if they would not think these unbelievers are substandard. I mean, they are not really human. And that it was so unhuman, so painful this time. So, I mean, millions killed for no reason whatsoever. No? I mean, wrong reasons. Now, Christianity and Islam claim we only have one God. All others have more God. But ultimately, it is more that they have diluted the concept of one God. Because in Sanatana Dharma, it is oneness, all is one. Everything is only Brahman. And in Christianity and Islam, we have God, separate entity. You must not claim that you are one with God. And apart from this, we have angels, we have Satan, we have human beings. let's debate in an interface dialogue. Let's really debate. So far, interface dialogues are really a sham. I went to two now, and it was just a promotion for Christianity and Islam. I wrote once in an article, Christians praise Christianity, Muslims praised Islam, and Hindus praised Christianity and Islam. I mean, it is really... And the bill the Hindus paid was very good lunch also. And in Dehradun I was in a interface dialogue, and there one could, and that one in Delhi one couldn't ask questions. There one could question, and I asked a question, and the Christian priest, he avoided immediately, he went immediately to personal experience. My personal experience with Jesus is, no? That's what they will always tell immediately. I said, it's not about you or what you feel, about the doctrine. Please speak about the doctrine. But he wouldn't, no chance. So disclaim that only we have one God is false, because the most pure oneness is here in India, from ancient times. And so we have to clarify this. And idol worshipper is for them the worst. They can do to us everything if they believe we are idol worshippers. And we need to be more clear in all this. Explain that Brahman is the essence in all, and that it can be experienced, and science supports it. And nowadays we talk so much about identity. What is our identity? Our identity ideally should be, I am Shiva, I am Brahman, I am divinity, I am, this is my truth. I don't think that the top clergy believes what they teach, the common people. The Pope recently, a few years ago, gave an interview to a German weekly newspaper, and there he said that atheists also will reach the place which Catholics will reach, means heaven. So was big thing, I mean, people were very much, it was a very great deviation. If any normal person would say it, of course it would be very normal, but when the Pope said it, it made a big splash. So soon after, a Vatican spokesman clarified that according to the Christian doctrine, only Catholics, one has to be baptized to go to heaven. Can you believe it? And a nice example also, when I told my mother when I was 18 or so, that I won't go to Mass anymore on Sunday, her first reaction was, what if you go to hell? I told her I won't go to hell. But many years later, I asked her once, are you still frightened that I go to hell? And then she said, no, I'm not frightened any longer. And what happened was that my uncle, her brother, who was a priest, he passed away now, he had told her, I am not worried about Maria. She's a good person. So, you know, he would preach, the common people should believe it, but even the priest does not. And the popes surely don't, because the way many of them lived, I mean, they would have to be very much frightened of eternal hell if it was there. No? So, yeah, and also in Islam, if they really believe that a jihadi, if you kill kafirs, has a higher state in paradise, it is in Quran, which says somebody who does jihad, and the jihad is meant not an inner jihad but an outer jihad, he secures a higher state in paradise. So if they really believe it, then all these old imams and mullahs who are terminally sick, why don't they do it? I mean, they don't believe it, obviously, no? If you can indoctrinate young people. But when you get a little older, you see different things. In Germany also, we have a saying, Translated, it means who believes it will get heavenly bliss. But this saying we say only when somebody tells obviously a lie. I mean, when it's very clear that this cannot be the truth, we say who believes it will get to heaven. So, I mean, common people had some wisdom, and but normally for the commoner, it's just, shh, it's a revelation, it's God's word. You must not touch it. And this, I feel, is also the reason why many Hindus do not touch it, because it's God's word, no? But then, can there be three truths? We really have to ask, no? First of all, can there be two truths? Christianity claims only truth. Islam claims only truth. They never sort it out, who is now true. They cannot sort it out because it's not possible. And there cannot be three truths. There is one imam from Saudi Arabia also, who was saying, I think Zakir Naik, Dr. Zakir Naik, he also repeated it afterwards, I heard him also. He said, the reason why no other religion is allowed in Saudi Arabia is because 2 and 2 is 4. There's only one answer. It cannot be 3 or 8 or, no? 2 and 2 is 4. And Islam is true. It's a true answer. We have to debate it. I mean, the most ancient revelations, there are 3 revelations, no? And the most ancient, which makes sense, the rishis would have never accepted somebody coming and saying, this is the truth. They would say, give me some proof, give me some evidence. You cannot just claim something. And I feel we have to go back to this stage also and have to be more honest. So which revelation is true? I mean, the Vedas is original, ancient, makes sense, can be experienced, is greatly beneficial for harmonious living, and it makes human beings better and not worse. When a religion makes somebody worse, then it's not. There's one point also, when in religious class, I remember having learned, if there's a conflict between your conscience and the church doctrine, you must choose the doctrine, which is... Now we have a problem nowadays, which is Islamic terrorism. In only 3 years, the migrants in Germany have managed to change the opinion towards them completely. In the beginning, people were welcoming them, volunteering and donating, and now common people are very, very wary. And what is the reason? Because many of them, unfortunately, take the claim that we, Germans, Kaffirs, are the worst of creatures, serious, and they can do, they can harm us. So this is, and we have a responsibility for these young people because they are gullible. It's, we have to expose the doctrine. If we only go after Zakir Naik and not mention that he draws actually from Quran, then we are not sincere, we are not doing our duty, I feel. I mean, it is difficult, I know, but the two points, jihad and belief, which are necessary for a Muslim, we have to question them, whether this can really be helpful for a harmonious society. I feel if we want to have a global society, really, then we need the mindset which Sanatana Dharma produces. We cannot have this divisive mindset of we alone are true and you go to hell. It is just not possible. So I wonder what can be done, I don't know. Every day new kids are brainwashed. It is going on daily. Now, every day. In Germany now there are kids, police is saying, they say, when I am big, I will kill you because you are a kafir. So that is, I wonder whether Asian country could petition, could do something that in the name of freedom of religion, you cannot provoke hate and cannot, yeah. So religion in the sense of binding to a doctrine, I find, has to go. People cannot be forced blindly. And we need an atmosphere where eternal hell and also jihad is criticized and even made fun of, ridiculed. Like in the 1960s, for example, in Germany, suddenly we could criticize the church. I think Yuri Gagarin, I don't know how he, the Russian astronaut, he had come back from space and he was telling that he has not seen God. And for us, I mean, we started questioning, yeah? And so, and we could get out from the church by then, so it, the church didn't reform, the clergy will not reform, they defend their fiefdom, but people have to get out. I feel that is the only way to make people realize that there's more to life and that there is a meaning in life and that we can discover it. And yeah, we have to spread this good news. There's a friend in Missouri. She once told me that a woman came to her kitchen door and told her, "Have you heard already the good news?" She said, "No, what?" He said, "Jesus has died for your sins." She said, "Please leave my house." But we have a really good news that divine presence is within. And we, if we do sadhana, we can also feel it. And it is worthwhile. We should really opt for trying to discover it, doing some sadhana. And I think it is no doubt the best option for humanity. And maybe you all can think how we go about to, I mean, India has to stand up. At present, the other two bully you, and you allow yourself to be put on the defensive, and you have no need to go on the defensive. One more point, what I feel very strongly also, thanks to Christianity and Islam and this Genesis claim that we can use animals just like tables or whatever and kill them, I feel it's very wrong. 56 billion of animals are killed, cows, goats, slaughtered. This is, and this would not happen if Sanatana Dharma would still be strong. Some maybe, in some cases it may be necessary, but this massive brutal slaughter is too inhuman. And yeah, by the way, the much maligned Manusmriti, it is very strong. Somebody who sells an animal, who kills it, who buys it, who cooks it, who serves it, who eats it, they all are murderers. So, yeah, thank you very much.